Does anybody have any comment on that?
I believe it's stating the same thing. I think it's kind of awkward to read. And on page four...
Just a minute, could you get that, Alice? Okay. Page four?
Third paragraph down. Second sentence that begins this board, I would suggest it read instead, "The applicant could come back to the board for an amendment like that, as might be done with DEP." And I think those are my only comments.
Any other comments? By your motion?
I move we accept the minutes as corrected.
Any discussion on the motion?
Second.
Any discussion on the motion? All those in favor, please indicate by raising your right hand. Thank you. Passes unanimously. We have quite an extensive list of correspondence, and for those items that are not pertinent to this evening's meeting, I'll just simply reference those. We have received a petition from the residents of South Portland regarding the Rosewood subdivision, which was proposed by Mr. Fastacci. Just for the public's knowledge, this project is not yet officially before the board. We've seen it in workshop meeting, but we do not have an application before the board at this time. But the petition has been received and is so acknowledged. The town planner has included comments and notes regarding her attendance of the American Planning Association annual meeting in San Francisco. I hope that all the board members have a chance to go through this in some detail. It's very, very good and a very nice overview of both the meetings and regional projects. We have an environmental newsletter on the development of a very interesting subject, most of us tree retention. In many applications, the applicants promise to save trees, and yet the outline for doing so is somewhat sketchy. And this is very good information, will be used in our office, I know that. There's a memo dated May 14, 1994 to South Portland City Council regarding Rosewood. It's from the South Portland citizens concerned about the impact of Rosewood subdivision. Again, we acknowledge receipt of that and we'll keep it on file. We also have a letter from Ost Associates regarding Linnell public access and wetland alteration permit applications. That will be discussed later in tonight's meeting. We have a letter from City Manager Jerry Bryan of South Portland regarding it's to Jerry Bryant from Michael K. McGovern, Town Manager of Cape Elizabeth, regarding the city staff participating in a meeting. So acknowledged having received that. Again, if that project gets before the board, there will be an opportunity at that time for the residents to be heard. We have a planning board that comments on the gifts policy. This was discussed at the last planning board meeting, and this simply revises the comments that were made and is given to the town council. Does anyone have any comments on that? That seem consistent? We have a letter from, or a memo from the code enforcement officer regarding Linnell public access waiver. We will look at that when we get to that item on the agenda. We have a very good memo from the Department of Environmental Protection on non-source pollution control. Again, this is an excellent reference for both planning board use as well as professional use. And finally, we have a record of the town council approval of the Linnell application right-of-way. Again, we'll get to that later. Now, I'd also like to acknowledge perhaps the town council is more appropriate to do so, but this community relies very much on its volunteers, and we do a lot of work as volunteers that are in most communities done through private consultants. And through the graces of our town planner, overseeing a committee in town that looked and studied at the town center and developed a town center plan, an application was submitted to the Maine Association of Planners for that project, and we received a honorable mention in 1994 recognition for outstanding contribution to the planning field, which I think is really terrific. There are many members in general, members of the planning board and other members involved. I don't have the list in front of me, so not wanting to short anyone, I'll leave it at that. With that, we'll proceed with old business, and first item on tonight's agenda is Linnell Public Access Waiver and Wetland Alterations Permit. This time I'll ask Maureen O'Meara, the town planner, to give us an overview of where we are and proceed from there. Maureen?
Mr. Linnell and Ms. Gauthier are requesting review of a project where they have a lot essentially located behind Lions Field with a right-of-way across a property owned by the town to access the lot, and they'd like to place a house on that lot. Because the existing road is within 250 feet of an RP1 wetland, they're in a critical wetland buffer and require a wetlands alteration permit. They also fall under the jurisdiction of the shoreland zoning overlay zone, and any road they put in that area also has to comply with the shoreland zoning provisions. Finally, because the lot does not have sufficient frontage on a town-accepted road, they also need a public access waiver. At the last meeting, the board deemed the application complete and scheduled a public hearing for this evening. Any questions?
No, I don't have any other questions by board members. At this time, what I'd like to do is have the, there was a site walk, and there were some issues raised at the site walk. What I'd like to do at this time is to have the applicant please present any changes or give us an overview since the site walk in the last meeting. And after that, we'll open it up to the public hearing.
Good evening. My name is Steve Harding. I work for Ost Associates. We're assisting Mr. Linnell and Ms. Gauthier with their project. As you recall from the site walk, there were a few issues that were questioned, one of which was at the beginning of the road, the access over here at Ocean House Road. There were some questions that have to do with the public access waiver requirements. We've spoken with Bob Malley, the Public Works Director, and he's confirmed that he has no problem with the way the intersection functions today. We've also discussed with T.Y. Lynn, the town's engineers, some of the criteria, the radius and the drainage sheeting across the intersection. We've discussed that. It doesn't appear to be any problem in anybody's that hasn't been able to be resolved, and that issue seems to be finalized. We've also discussed with the town council the areas that we would like to fill and the ditch slopes and the culverts that we'd like to put in beyond the 40-foot right-of-way, and I believe that that approval is in your package tonight. That area is represented in yellow on the plan to the left. One other issue that was arisen was some unauthorized cutting in the wetland buffer area of some trees. The code enforcement's been notified of that. Mr. Linnell has been working with code enforcement on that issue. He's hired a professional consultant in the woodlot area to help him with that plan, and that issue is being resolved through code enforcement. The revisions to the plan have been, there's been no changes in the design or the design concepts. Basically, most of the revisions are just simply notes clarifying issues that are pertinent with the public access waiver, and to help clearly identify some of the items in the plan. If there are any specific questions, I could try to answer those now.
Okay, thank you. I would like to open the meeting. Are there any questions at this time with the board? I'd then like to open the meeting for public hearing. Anyone interested in commenting either for or against the project, please come to the podium and introduce yourself and state your name and address. At this time, is there anyone who would like to speak about the project?
I'd like to ask a question. I'm not speaking for or against.
Would you please stand up and introduce yourself?
My name is Dick Coughlin. I live at Wildwood, and I was unable to attend the previous hearing, so maybe this was covered. But the question relates to the road coming in from Ocean House to the site. I mean, is that considered to be a driveway or an approved road, or what? And where the question is leading is, you know, I assume that during the winter, that in the future that would have to be plowed, and I wonder whether it is plowed now. I'm you know, leading up to you know, who's responsible for the plowing financially and from the standpoint of safety and things like that.
Okay, thank you. We'll see if there's any other comment and then get back to that question. Are there any other members of the public that wish to speak at this time? Hearing none, I'll close the public hearing. Would the applicant please address the question regarding maintenance?
In the first indenture that was signed through the council, there's some language regarding snow plowing and maintenance of the road. And it states in that the town, it is the intent of the town to maintain the first 750 feet of the road and do the snow plowing. However, it is not their responsibility. They're not fully relinquishing that responsibility. And that it is also, if that doesn't get done, then the Linnell Gautier can come in and do that work, and it's given that right. After this existing gravel ends, it's up strictly up to Bill and Joyce to clean the road.
Just one other question to be answered. How is the road classified, Maureen?
It would be considered a driveway. It's only serving one lot.
A private drive.
Yep.
Okay. Thank you. This time I'll ask the board if they have any questions regarding the application. Mr. Edsel?
Back on the issue that was just addressed, I was looking quite quickly for the language that was published earlier. And I think it says the first 750 feet. Approximately how far does 750 feet go? Is that to the baseball diamond?
Yeah, this scale is 1 inch equals 100, so it's 7.5 inches from right here. And it's approximately right to the base, the storage shed.
I think the language also says that they will do snow removal and maintenance for its own use, meaning the town's own use. Is that the understanding of the applicant? In other words, if the town decides it's not going to use the baseball park during the winter, it may plow to that there's no anticipation by the applicant to,
that's true.
That the town will provide further.
Thank you. Any other questions? Yes, Ms. Lardner?
I have probably one question for Maureen and one for the applicant. The town engineer raised the issue of discharge from a proposed culvert that would discharge the runoff to town property. Do you know if that was discussed by the town and whether it was felt that there was an easement needed just for the discharge of the water and not the actual culvert location?
I wasn't at the council meeting, so you can probably help us out on that. But
no, there wasn't any discussion on the culvert itself. I think the culvert in question is this culvert here that's on actually the Linnell Gautier property. Mm-hmm. As you remember from the sidewalk, there's a hill up here, mm-hmm. and that the runoff comes down the hill through this way and off this way and through that swale. Basically, this is just a relief culvert to keep a low spot from being created behind the turnaround. And what we're trying to do here is just discharge the water under the road and make sure that this turnout doesn't get washed out.
You had relocated all the culvert inverts and outlets, hadn't you, so they were completely within the right-of-way? Like, at one point, they actually were out of the right-of-way?
Oh, they're still out of the right-of-way. We've got them here. But those culvert inlets and outlets and the riprap that's going to be placed around them to protect them is within the easement that the council approved last Thursday.
The other question I'd have for you is, I'd ask Mr. Linnell to be prepared to address the Conservation Commission's request that pedestrian access be allowed on the portion of the tote road on his property.
Okay, I can try that, and if you feel like you should add something, go ahead. We discussed that, and with the road through here, this is all within the town's property, and the adjacent field is all town property. And I think the applicants feel that it's certainly, if somebody wants to use this portion of the road in a reasonable manner, then they should be allowed to. However, when you get to the woods line here that defines the property line, I think that's where the respect of the private owner has to be taken into account. Basically, this is going to be the front driveway and their front yard. And to allow people to walk through there or use mountain bikes or four-wheelers, I think that should be discouraged, and that we'd like to keep the people from passing through the woods line. Along the same point, you can see where the existing tote road kind of goes through the parcel. The abutter to this side has gone and placed a fence barricade here, a fence barricade here, because he's had problems with people coming up through his backyard with four-wheelers and mountain bikes. So that access through there has already been blocked off.
Thank you.
Is that it, Judy?
I think so.
Thank you. Mr. Parkhurst.
I was only present for half of the site walk, so a couple of these things may have been answered, but having a son on the baseball team that's been playing at Lions Field this season, I realize how difficult the parking situation is there, and I'm just wondering, is there what is going to be done to allow Mr. Linnell access to his lot? Because when we're there for games, it seems that the roadway at best is difficult to travel, if not impossible. That's question number one. Is there going to be a deed restriction on the other lots so to prevent further development? And number three, the logging issue, I think I would like to know how that is being resolved with the code enforcement officer.
Yeah, the first issue, the parking along the gravel road, there should be allowances for emergency vehicles to get in, certainly to the end of Lions Field in case something happens where you need to get an ambulance in there. So I think that area, this area through here, there should be some kind of a maintenance or a policing of the roadway to ensure that people stay off to the side and allow at least passage of one vehicle through there. I don't think you're going to run into a problem through here. This is going to become less desirable for people to access. The issue of a deed restriction, I believe you're talking about these two lots up here. Those two lots really are just shown to indicate the extent of Mr. Linnell's and his sister and his and Ms. Gaudier's property up through here. This public access waiver is only for the bottom lot right through here. Doesn't seem like to the applicants that these two lots should become part of this discussion, or that there should be a deed restriction limiting the development potential of those two lots. Certainly if the time came that they felt they could develop those or they wanted to develop them, they would have to go through the same process that we're going through now, and that they would be scrutinized through the same process. There is no development plans for those two lots right now, and as the rules of Cape Elizabeth and nature would have it, the large wetland here certainly discourages access to those two lots through either this roadway here or this lot. For the code enforcement issue, I think a code enforcement officer is here if you would like to hear from him directly.
My name is Ernie McVane, code enforcement officer, and a plan is being drawn by the applicant which will show all the cutting, the areas, the open areas, the amount of slash, etc. And at that point, if there's a violation, I emphasize that because we haven't determined that yet, I will sit down with the applicants and determine what course of action would take at that time. It may vary, it may come back to the board, it may be just internally done through our department, but again, we haven't determined that there is a violation at this time, and we need to proceed with those drawings and go from there. Any questions?
Mr. McVane, you stated that at this time there is a violation or there is
there
not?
There isn't a violation.
There is not.
No.
Okay. Mr.
Let me qualify that. He should have provided us a plan prior to cutting. So, yes, with regards to not providing us a plan, that portion of the ordinance was overlooked. But beyond that, it hasn't been determined whether he's exceeded the criteria in the ordinance for clearing of for timber harvesting.
Okay. Mr. Edsel?
I was just trying to think back the last time we had an application where there was a violation in process or you were reviewing, and I think that goes back to perhaps the Highlands. And I just, in the face of consistency and your preference as code enforcement officer, any wishes on your part to table action here until the violation issue is resolved?
No. I see this as a separate issue.
Okay.
Anything else?
Any other questions of Mr. McVane?
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Edsel?
Yeah. Other question, and it goes along with Stephen's comment, and I think I originally brought up the issue of the parking on the right-of-way that was conveyed by the town council, and how I foresaw that is a real problematic issue. I've labored over that, trying to see how the planning board's, whether that's within our purview or not. The health and safety issues are always our purview. I just don't know that there's a way to either place a condition on that right-of-way. I think in granting the easement as it has been granted, the horse is out of the barn. I'm not sure that the planning board can actually do anything about it. As part of the record, I would want it to, that I see this as a problematic issue in that we have a right-of-way for travel and the use of town citizens use it actually for parking, and when somebody actually has conveyed that easement over the same area that is used for parking, I think in the future going to be a problem. It's only a problem for a few weeks each spring and a few weeks in the wintertime when there's ice skating on the pond. But I just hope that it never, if it's a matter of inconvenience, that's one thing. If it's a matter of emergency or tragic accident, I hope that it doesn't fall in time. I've come to my own resolution that I don't think it's within our purview to try to make a condition to change.
Thank you. Any other comments? Peter or Roy?
None.
I guess to follow up on Mr. Edsel's issue with respect to parking, there are two issues. One is the existing shed that's located in the right-of-way. As I understand it, the reason it's in its location is that it can't be placed closer to the field on a permanent basis because of the resource protection area surrounding the pond and the adjacent wetlands. Would the applicant please state for the record your understanding of the siting of the shed?
My understanding, or it says in the it says in the not easement, and it says in the indenture that we don't have an objection with the building being where it is. The town manager did say publicly that at some point in the next year or two, some such time, that they would find another home for it. But as far as something legally binding from my point of view, all I have is the town manager's word, which I'm comfortable with.
Okay, thank you. I share the same, I don't know if the word is concern, but certainly observation, having had two children use Lions Field for recreation purposes and parking is indeed always a concern in that area. I don't know whether the concern lies with the pre-existing use by the town's recreational, it's not officially sanctioned by the town, but there is an existing use there that is likely to cause, there's no excuse for causing disruption to emergency vehicles, whether those would be emergency vehicles going to an emergency at the ball field or a fire at the Linnell residence in any event. But I certainly trust that the applicant acknowledges the pre-existing use of parking adjacent to the right-of-way, and that reasonable access is typically one way there during certain hours of the day. And I'd just like to hear from the applicant if you have any objections to that pre-existing condition.
I'm certainly not against Little League. I play Little League. And I would certainly, you know, if a car is slightly in the way, I'm not going to, you know, my first reaction is not to call a tow truck. I would try and find the owner to move it. But I would like to state that as far as a pre-existing condition, the town attorney acknowledged, I believe, I think it's fair to say, that this right-of-way goes back to, it's recorded, like, I think, to 1836 or something. So as far as the right-of-way was pre-existing before there was ever a baseball field there. Again, having said that, I'm certainly willing to overlook any small transgressions on the part of the Little League as far as getting to my house. I would much rather have a house there than be denied a house because someone is parking slightly in the way. And so I think that, again, there is this emergency vehicle situation, and again, it has to be open for emergency vehicles, whether we are there, whether it remains a woodlot or not. It would have to, it seems to me that the interest of public and safety would dictate that it remain open.
Okay. Mr. Edsel?
I think, you know, the verbiage in the indenture states that this is for use in common with others. Unfortunately, it doesn't make that any more clear than simply that. It also states that the grantees hereby release any other rights they may have to a right-of-way over the grantor's land. And I think the intent of that language is to say that you give up rights for other right-of-ways or any other portion of the land. Unfortunately, this indenture isn't stated that way. It says you've given up all other rights. I think the issue is whether it's this applicant or a future owner, where if the problem persists, comes back to the town and says, we were transferred this interest in this land to pass and repass across this land. We need to make provisions, and so the town is forced in some way to build a parking lot instead of just parking on the road, and I'm not sure that there's a lot of land on that site. As far as I'm concerned, that is an issue that should have been addressed at the town council level. It wasn't, and I think that's, we just live with that.
I agree. Mr. Parkhurst.
Yeah, I guess just one other point to sort of go along with this whole parking issue. Having been over there, arriving early for a couple of games and seeing, I think it was girls' softball games there, with visiting teams that arrived in full-size school buses, I'm not so sure that there's room anywhere else except on the road for those school buses to park, given the turnaround into the parking lot next to the ball field that is off the road. And I didn't try to drive a car beside the school bus. I'm not sure if you could. So that may become an issue at certain times as well. I just wanted that to be part of the comments here.
Okay, thank you. Any other comments or questions? Do I need two motions? Do I hear a motion? Ms. Lardner?
I propose the following motion for the board to consider findings of fact. One, William Linnell and Joyce Gauthier are requesting a public access waiver, wetland alterations permit, and shoreline zoning compliance review for reconstruction of a road to lot R2-21 located off of Ocean House Road behind Lyons Field. Two, the application was deemed complete at the May 1994 meeting and a public hearing was held June 21, 1994. Three, the application substantially complies with the requirements of the public access waiver, section 19-4-2B, wetlands alteration permit, section 19-3-9, and shoreline zoning performance standard, section 19-3-6F. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of William Linnell and Joyce Gauthier for a public access waiver, wetlands alteration permit, and shoreline zoning performance standards for reconstruction of a road to access one lot, R2-21, located behind Lyons Field on Ocean House Road, be granted with the following condition. One, the westerly leg of the gravel turnaround shall be widened to 24 feet to allow adequate turning radius for fire equipment.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
I'll second the motion.
Any discussion?
I guess I'd like to state for the record, we didn't discuss the town engineer or the fire chief's request that it be widened, but it had been a topic at the last meeting. And I assume maybe the applicant should tell if they agree to that.
Do you have any objection with the requirement?
No, we have no objection, and we will work with Mr. McGoldrick and T. Welland and straighten that out.
Okay. Any other discussion on the motion? I guess I would have a question of the board then. Does the board feel it necessary to add language to the motion with respect to a satisfactory resolution regarding the timber harvesting issue?
Mr. Chair, it's my opinion that the violation of not giving notice to code enforcement and perhaps any violation that might exist could have easily happened after this fact, and it seems like a separate issue to me.
Okay.
And I agree. I mean, we have the ability to bring it back to the board anyway through the code enforcement officer. And that's why I asked if the code enforcement officer, if they wished that we table it, and he said no.
Okay. Thank you. I have a motion and second. All those in favor, please indicate by raising your right hand. Motion passes unanimously. You have your approval. Thank you. Last item on tonight's agenda under old business is an application of the Jelen boat ramp requested by William Jelen. Maureen, could you please give us some background on this, please?
Mr. Jelen is proposing what I have been corrected and am now referring to as a gangway and boat float. Gangway because it is 3 feet wide down to the area where there is a float that is supposed to be there on a temporary basis and moored. With this project, Mr. Jelen is required to get what we call an RP3 permit. It's a permit because they're in the Resource Protection 3 zone, otherwise known as the floodplain. You borrow the procedures from the wetlands alteration permit process, but you look at a floodplain permit instead of a wetlands alteration permit. Because, again, it's in the floodplain, you borrow the standards and submission requirements from the floodplain ordinance, then use the standards of the procedures of the wetlands permit. Also, because it's in the shoreline zone, it's required to get review under that section of shoreline zoning, and the shoreline zoning also requires site plan review. So these four different sets of regulations are involved. What you will find once you look at those standards is that, for the most part, they don't really apply very well to this project because it's fairly unique and it's located over water. With that said, the board did hold that the application was complete at the May meeting and has scheduled a public hearing for this evening. Are there any questions?
I'm sure there are many, but no one's willing to admit it at this point. certainly a very complicated series of events, and I hope we can keep this as simple as possible. Is there someone here this evening to represent the applicant that could give us a brief discussion of the additional information that's been provided and any additional information since the site walk?
The additional information that was provided...
Excuse me, could you please introduce yourself?
My name is Harold Pacious. I'm an attorney in Portland, and I'm the attorney for the applicant and also a friend of the applicant. I told the applicant to be here at 8:15 because that's what I saw on the agenda, said 7:50, but that's all right. I can begin this. Also, the engineer was trapped because of high winds on Vinyl Haven, where he was installing a float, and he should be here in about 15 minutes, driving down from Rockland. There was a bad weather up there, and he called me about 1:30 or 2 o'clock and was having difficulty getting off the island. And they will be able to respond to some questions. Mr. Chairman, I have a question about process here, and you can tell me where this comes in. I want to discuss this project. Generally, a lot of people here who have not been at the previous meetings and do not know what you all know about the project and the extent of it. Mm-hmm. And also, I'd like an opportunity to discuss with the board the ordinance and the requirements of the ordinance and whether or not this project accommodates the requirements of the ordinance. I don't know when you want me to do that, but I'd like an opportunity at some point to do that.
I think it would be appropriate at this time, unless any of the members want to discuss it or object, to give an overview of the project so that everyone in the room has the same understanding that we have.
And then when would it be appropriate to discuss with the board the provisions of the ordinance and make my points with respect to how this project accommodates the ordinance?
I think for the public record, it should be done as part of the public hearing process rather than at the close of the public hearing.
So I should wait until the public hearing and then...
Why don't you do it prior to the public hearing? That will give us the information. It will also allow members of the public an opportunity to comment on any issues that arise at that point.
But why don't I give an overview then of the project and then take 3 or 4 minutes to go through the standards and discuss the project in the context of the standards?
Certainly.
I would add, I just walked in while Maureen was speaking, and she was speaking about the wetlands ordinance and about the floodplain ordinances. As the chairman knows, we have provided all of the information required by those portions of the ordinance. I would like to state here for the record that it is my opinion that neither the floodplain management ordinance or the wetlands ordinance are applicable to this project. And so I don't want the fact that we filed the materials to accommodate those requirements to be read as a waiver of that argument that they are not applicable. What I think is applicable here is shorelands overlay and a site plan review. And I would be happy, rather than take up your time now, I would, if you'd like, respond later or whenever you think appropriate to why I do not think those two portions of the overall zoning ordinance are appropriately applied here.
I'll invite you to go ahead. I would just simply ask why this wasn't presented to the town planner prior to a public hearing, if this is indeed an issue.
It isn't an issue, and I'm not making it an issue, and I don't want to spend your time with it. I'm just saying that I don't want to waive my rights with respect to that.
Okay, thank you. Why don't you go ahead then and give your reasons?
There are, let me also, before I begin, say that I do have some letters here from some of the people in the area, and Mr. Jellin also has a couple, and I will provide those to the board when he comes in. I can put them all together in a package.
Now, those letters received after the last meeting or prior to the submittal date?
I think that, I can't, one may have been before that, I can't recall, I don't think it was.
Why don't we just back up for a minute? Could you provide the overview that we discussed and then get into the pertinent issues of the ordinance or the issues that you take with the ordinance?
At least one person has said to me that this is an unusual project and that it creates what that person thinks is a precedent that should not be created, which is the establishment of a dock or pier or a float and ramp apparatus in an area used by the public. As I have pointed out before, I have had personal experience with Maiden Cove and have for 50 years resided near the cove and beginning in 1938 spent every summer on that beach. There was always a raft anchored in the cove, and for many, many years until I think it was the storm of 77 or 78, there was a pier in the cove. The vista was not much different than what it was now. And at the time, my parents lived where I lived, and you could look over there and look at the pier and so forth. The ordinance, not only were these things in the cove, but the ordinance comprehends this kind of a structure. First of all, the ordinance defines a boat launching facility, which includes access ramp and docking area. The ordinance also defines marine structures, which include piers and docks. The ordinance also, under accessory uses, includes in definitions of accessory use wharfs, docks, and boathouses. So the town of Cape Elizabeth, through its municipal officers, have adopted an ordinance which envisions the potential of these kinds of things. The drafters of the ordinance and the council could have said, we don't want any docks, wharfs, or floats in the town of Cape Elizabeth. They chose not to do that and instead affirmatively provide for it. The subject matter of Section C of the Shorelands Overlay Zoning Regulations is, in fact, as a subject matter, piers, docks, and other marine structures. So the matter of whether this is a precedent, I think, is not a relevant one, Mr. Chairman, since the council has already seen fit to make provision for these kinds of uses and structures. Marine uses are explicitly permitted when in conformity with the applicable regulations. And that's exactly what it says in the shorelands overlay provisions of the ordinance, that when in compliance with these regulations, they are permitted. So the issue here is, of course, the regulations. Now, let me briefly describe what we have here. We have a raft which is 24 feet long, 8 feet long. It is out in front of the Jelen residence, and it will be anchored in front of the Jelen residence for 3 months. Come Labor Day, it will be towed away probably to South Portland, and probably around the middle of June, it will be towed back. So 2.5 months, let's say 3 months at the outset, it will be there. It will not be very far offshore into the cove. It will be very close to the Jelen residence. And in fact, at low tide, and a regular low tide, this float, this raft, the nearest end of it will be 7 yards from the shore. So closer than I am to the chairman. You just weighed out. In fact, at low water, there's 18 inches of water on the near side. So it is designed in order to be near Mr. Jelen's house. You cannot, according to the designer, leave boats there overnight because in a regular turn of the tides, the boats would ground out. Mr. Jelen asked the harbor master for a place to put two moorings, and those moorings went in after you made your site visit, but some of the others here may have seen the moorings. They're pretty far out to sea, over pretty much in front of my house and Mr. Kurtz's house. They're a long way from his house. On a drainer tide, I might add, but when we have drainer tides, this thing for a short time during the turn of the tide will actually have only a tiny bit of water under it. The moorings that exist in the cove will be 20 to 20, the nearest one would be 20 to 25 yards seaward of this float. Now, so it takes up...
Excuse me. Is that the mooring for the vessels, or is that the mooring to hold the raft?
No, the mooring for the vessel, for the other boats that already exist in the cove. The fact is that the raft itself, which is a very small raft, will take up a tiny portion of the cove area, a minuscule portion of the cove area. The connection from the raft to Mr. Jelen's house is a retractable ramp that comes in underneath his house and is stored underneath the house, and then electronically a button can be pushed and it'll go out, go down to the water, and then and connect with the raft to be used when he's going down the ramp to gain access or returning up the ramp. So the raft will be there for 3 months. For 9 months of the year, there will be nothing there, absolutely nothing. During the remaining 3 months, for 99% of the time, all that will be visible is a raft very low to the water and a small raft. For just a few hours out of the year, the ramp will be deployed so that Mr. Jelen can go down to the raft and return from the raft. Mr. Jelen, somebody said to me, well, why can't Mr. Jelen get a skiff and put it on the beach like others have done in the past and just drag it down over the beach and into the water and row out to those two moorings? First, I would have had a different argument if the moorings would have been somewhere else, but if you look at those moorings, it's quite a distance to row out. Secondly, Mr. Jelen has had two very serious cancer operations in the last 3 years. I don't know if he's arrived here yet, but you may have noticed the last time that he was here that he has to keep his leg up. He can put no strain on his leg, and frankly, he cannot drag a skiff over the water. People are concerned about aesthetics, as they should be, having lived the last 50 years of my life in that area and loving that cove and starting there back in 1938, I'm concerned about aesthetics. I can see that cove from my house, so I can understand people's feelings. Mr. Jelen is more concerned than I am. Mr. Jelen has spent a lot of money on building a house that he wants to be very attractive. extremely attractive, and he's invested a lot of money in it. And what he wanted was access to the water from that house, but in a way that would not be aesthetically displeasing to him or others. He doesn't want his house, the looks of his house, to be diminished by this. He doesn't want his view of the cove or view of the ocean to be diminished by this. And so instead of having a permanent ramp that would stay out for 3 months, he chose a design that would satisfy his own desire to have a clean look out there, with his desire to get access to the water, and therein lies this invention, this retractable ramp. The question of whether some people say, well, could be dangerous for children. I think there's two issues where it could be dangerous for children. Certainly, if a child were to, or somebody were to dive off the pier in low water, that could be dangerous. If they dove off the cliff in low water, that would be dangerous. In fact, there are all kinds of activities on a beach that are dangerous for children. We certainly will go either way. If you approve this, which I think you should do, we're certainly willing to work regularly with the Beach Association to make whatever rules they want for use of it or non-use of it, to change them whenever they would like them changed, to accommodate them in any way they would like to be accommodated. Now, in terms of boat traffic coming in, there are, of course, boats that come in and out of the cove all the time. I dare say I have a boat. I like the cove. I like to pick up somebody else's moorings. I never know who it is, but I go over frequently in the summertime, almost every weekend, and for at least a few minutes or an hour, pick up an empty mooring and sit there. So I motor into that cove, and so do a lot of other people. I don't think what we're doing is adding one more boat, and I don't think that one more boat using the cove, which is incidentally a public cove and open to all boats, is a particular problem. I do think that whenever I go into the cove in my boat, I need to be careful, because there are people that swim in that cove. And I need to be particularly careful when I go in among the moorings closest to shore and make a turn. I'm always very, very alert, because you want to make sure that nobody is swimming in the area. In terms of diving off the dock, again, that's something that we're going to leave to the Beach Association. They can either say that the members of the association want to use it or not want to use it, whatever the case may be. I'd like to, and then we'll have our engineer here in a minute, and he can answer some specific questions, and I will be available to answer specific questions, but I would like to turn briefly, if I may, Mr. Chairman, with your permission, to the standards, the things that the ordinance says we're required to meet in order to get your approval here tonight. Is that appropriate?
That's fine. Mm-hmm.
The specific regulations with respect to wharves, docks, and piers are found in paragraph C of the Shorelands Performance Overlay Zone Regulations. That's on page, and the standards themselves, that's on page 38, begins, and the standards themselves are on page 39 of the ordinance. Those, as the town planner pointed out, some of the standards simply don't make sense in terms of this kind of a project, particularly with the ramp is retractable and almost all of the time not out over the water connecting to the float. The first, if you have it in front of you, the first one relates to soils, and of course soils are not an issue because the ramp comes out underneath the house and connects down on the water. Interference with access to the beach or points of public access. As I explained, this raft is not in front of the beach. It's in front of Mr. Jellin's house, which hangs over the rocks. Anyone can walk underneath it. There is a very large vertical clearance. So if you want to walk on the rocks or at low tide, the sand, which is in the foreground of the rocks during low tide period, you just walk underneath the ramp when it's down. Again, and I want to keep repeating this almost all the time, it's up. It's not down. So there would be no obstacle whatsoever to access back and forth on those rocks or in that little sandy area in front of the rocks, which is all in front of Mr. Jellin's house. The third standard is that the applicant must mitigate adverse impacts on wildlife, fisheries, marshes, eelgrass, birds, and nursery areas. And for the most part, of course, this is not applicable to this kind of project. The raft itself will have, it'll just be a float, 24 feet long, will have no effect on these things, so it is impossible to mitigate. The engineer, in his submission, did note that there's some barnacles on some of the rock where the float is anchored, and so that there may be some barnacles that are disturbed by it. That's covered in his submission, but there are no adverse impact on wildlife, fisheries, marshes, grass, birds, and nursery areas. The fourth standard is interference with streams or surface or subsurface water courses, and that is not applicable here either. That's obviously refers to a pier which is anchored on land and where you're building a cement abutment or some kind of abutment on land and disturbing the earth in order to do this. The fifth, and this is applicable to this project, the fifth standard under shorelands overlay is that it shall not encroach on navigation channels, mooring areas, or landing places. Now, you have, I think, a photo that Mr. Waterman, the designer, took. Am I correct, Maureen, that you have a photograph of the area?
Yes, we do.
Okay. If you look at the photo, which shows the entire cove and has superimposed on it the dock, you'll see that the dock occupies an extraordinarily small area of the water just in front of Mr. Jellin's house, and a very small area of the cove itself. I mean, in the context of the cove and on the scale of the cove, this float is very small, 24 feet long. So it is not in the middle of the moorings. Boats, I've been in there with my boat and into the area where this float is going to be, and I have a 32-foot boat, and if you're wanting to tie up to the moorings, this has you're pretty far away from this area, and it has no effect on navigation. So it will be no problem at all for boats, I happen to know this because I do it, to navigate in that area. It will not interfere with any of the moorings. It's some distance away from the moorings. The next standard, standard number six under shorelands overlay, as specifically applied to wharves, piers, and docks, are the dimensional limits, specific dimensional limits, which the applicant must meet. The first is that it cannot be more than 100 feet in length, and this float is 24 feet. And we're talking about a floating dock, and the floating dock is 24 feet long. Secondly, the float cannot be more than 200 square feet, and this is 198 square feet. The seventh standard relates to subdivisions, and that clearly is not applicable. The eighth relates to restrictions against building a dock over an abutting dock or pier, and that clearly is not applicable here. The ninth relates to the conversion of a floating dock or pier to a dwelling unit. In other words, somebody builds a pier, and then when they get the pier built a couple years later, they now want to build a little house on the end of it. This, of course, is a 3-month, 8-foot, 24-foot float, and there'd be no house or dwelling unit built on it. The 10th, again, relates to structures built on a dock, pier, or wharf, and there's no other structure to be built on it. Now, in addition to those are all the standards which are in the shorelands overlay. Now, in addition to these standards, paragraph C of shorelands overlay regs specify that docks require site plan approval. So it is appropriate to turn to section 19.210 of the ordinance, and specifically paragraph D, which contains the standards for site plan approval. And I'll go over these quickly, Mr. Chairman, and you're all much more familiar with them than I am. Number one is pedestrian and vehicular circulation, and that's clearly not applicable here. Number two, second standard, is entrance and exit driveways. That's not applicable here. Number three is the layout of buildings and parking areas. That's not applicable here. Number four is lighting, and there's no lighting on this float. Number five is a buffering with shrubs, fencing, trees, and that's inapplicable here. Six requires a design of a plan which mitigates any adverse impact on several elements. And the plan must mitigate, according to the ordinance, the plan must mitigate adverse impact on, among others, soil erosion, trees, topography, animal life. Those obviously apply to building structures or parking lots or roads or whatever on land. Another element which the design must address and mitigate is noise. Boats make noise. When my boat goes in there, it makes noise. When Mr. Jellin's sailboat goes in, it won't make noise. When he drives his motorboat in there, it will make noise, and so do all the other motorboats in the cove. So as distinguished between his motorboat and my motorboat or anybody else's motorboat that may either moor or visit the cove, there cannot be drawn a distinction, I submit. The next, under standard number six, the next element that the designer must consider in the effort to mitigate is the protection of significant vistas. 99% of the time, what we'll have here is a small raft close to the waterline, fairly near shore, with no profile. When I say no profile, I mean in comparison to boats that may be moored. We all understand the raft is very low to the water and has very little profile. There will be a time, as I explained earlier, several hours during a year, and just several hours during that three-month period, when Mr. Jelen is going down the ramp to gain access to the water, or going up the ramp to leave the water, when the ramp will be deployed, electronically deployed, from underneath his house. Now, the question is, that ramp, in the context of significant vistas, if marine uses, particularly docks, are not eyesores, then this is not an eyesore. And in fact, the designer will tell you that he thinks it's absolutely beautiful. Moreover, the man who is spending a lot of money to build and live in the house, which is over the ramp, would not want something unattractive to spoil his investment. In fact, as all of us know, marine uses, piers, floats abound on the coast of Maine, more here than any other state in all of the country, particularly in areas of high property values, particularly there. Any of you have been to Northeast Harbor? Any have been to Islesboro and Dark Harbor, to Camden, to Booth Bay, indeed to Falmouth Foreside? These are all over the place. The difference is that in every one of those cases, there are ramps which are permanently deployed for 3 months or 4 months, not retractable, permanently deployed. And the people in those areas, I dare say, I don't want to speak for them, but I think the people that live in those areas think it's attractive and it's part of coastal Maine. They expect to see marine uses on the coast of Maine. Mr. Waterman, as I said, thinks it's beautiful. His business depends on it. This is how he makes his living, and he takes a great deal of pride in the kind of work he does up and down the coast of Maine. And Mr. Jelen insists on it. So for this ramp, which will be deployed just a few hours out of the 8,726 hours every year, he wants it to be beautiful, and it is close to shore. So these are the standards, both shorelands overlay and site plan. And in our opinion, this small dock clearly meets the standards. Now, having said that it meets the standards, Mr. Jelen and I recognize that there is opposition to this project for reasons other than what the ordinance contemplates. And I just want to, in 1 or 2 minutes, address that. While not technically relevant, I think it is important to address them. First, there is the natural resistance to change, and I can understand that. I can understand that. Any change. When the old Ralph raft disappeared, the one I'd grown up with in that cove, I was a little sad. When the old pier disappeared, and it wasn't particularly beautiful, but I'd grown up with it, and when it went in that storm, I kind of felt a little lost. Things would be different. The cove would look different. The pier was gone. Secondly, I think that a lot of people didn't have an opportunity to, some did, but a lot didn't, to hear what this was all about. I remember the first meeting we had over in the house over here. Mrs. Gibbons, who I've known for years, was there. And and afterwards she said, well, I was concerned because I saw in the announcement boat ramp. And she said, I had this vision of launching boats and this huge structure. And that's what I had in my mind. And she said, now I don't I'm not concerned about this, but I had this vision of something large, and I think a lot of people did. We did have the opportunity to have the officers of the Beach Association view the site and to have the description from George Waterman. So I think it helps when they understand what it's going to look like, that most of the time is just a float. It isn't going to interfere with anybody's view. That for a few hours, what we think is an attractive ramp, far more attractive than you see in most places like Dark Harbor and Northeast Harbor, will be deployed. And that it's only, 7 yards offshore, at low water, from me to you. Mr. Jelen has committed himself, as his chairman and members of the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board, to probably the least obtrusive and most expensive float and ramp in this area and probably on the coast of Maine. He has done so in order to minimize any change to the area because he recognizes that people don't like change. There may be people who don't like what he's doing to his house because they like the feel of the old house. So he understands that people don't like change, often don't. But for 9 months out of the year, it won't even exist. And for all but a few hours, all that will be there is the float. If you want me to just briefly address my views on floodplain management and wetlands, I will, Mr. Chairman, though we have made all of the submissions required by it. Mm-hmm. I just don't think it's a technical matter.
At this point, I think what I'd like to do is proceed to the public hearing, and if there's an issue that arises from that, that can be dealt either with the planning board later or through the planner.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
You're welcome. What I'd like to do then is, are there any immediate questions of the board? What I'd like to do then is open up the meeting, the public hearing portion of the meeting, and I see a lot of people in the room, and although this is the last item on the agenda, we would like to keep the time reasonable. If people, either as a group or as a neighborhood, have common concerns that they would like to have a spokesperson addressed before the board, we'd certainly welcome that. If you are last rather than first before the board and your concerns are similar or reinforce other concerns, it may not be necessary at the end of the evening to get up and continue the same presentation. Additionally, we have received correspondence in our packets, and I will publicly read those at the end of the public hearing, and I'll ask the town planner to please remind me to do so. With that, at this time, I'd officially open the public hearing and ask anyone who wishes to speak for or against the boat ramp to please come to the podium and raise your hand. Yes, the lady here was first. Please come to the podium, introduce yourself, and give your name and address.
My name is Tina Harnden. I live at 13 Rocky Hill Road, and I'm a member of the Cape Cottage Beach Association. My question pertains, this is actually a question rather than speaking for or against the ramp. I'm curious as to how the ramp is going to operate when it comes down, when Mr. Jelen pulls his boat up and he wants the retractable portion of the ramp to come down and meet the dock in the water. How is that going to work? Because it seems to me that it's on a float system at the bottom of the ramp, and I know there was originally two floats, and it was going to land on one of those floats. Now that second float is gone, how is it going to get to the float, and what kind of impact is it going to have on the water and the surrounding area when it comes out?
That's a good question. I can answer it, but Mr. Waterman designed it. Is he here yet?
Yeah. Yeah.
George, would you come up here, please, and answer that?
I didn't see you come in.
Yeah, he did.
I'm George Waterman from Freeport. I'm a marine designer and contractor. This project is my baby. Working on the design of this for over a year, and the reason for that is that it is very unique in the way that it functions. We eliminated the inner float in order to bring the proposed system into conformity with all of the regulations that affected it, in particular the amount of square footage of float that we could have. What we did in order to substitute for the elimination of the inner float was we designed the extension mechanism so that once the ramp is out far enough so that it overbalances itself and the outboard end of it descends to the water, there is enough flotation in that end to keep it on the surface until it goes out far enough to connect into the float proper. So in effect, we cheated a little bit, because what happens is temporarily for a few seconds we actually have an itty-bitty second float, but that disappears. It's eaten by the main float proper, so that once the ramp is connected into the main float, that little bit of flotation that's in the outer end of the ramp is subsumed therein, and we're back to our 198 square feet.
Excuse me, would you please come to the podium and ask the question?
I'm wondering how heavy the ramp is at that point when it hits the water. I'm just curious as to how much of an impact it's going to have.
Excuse me for a minute. Mr. Waterman, Mr. Patius made a presentation. I think it would be worthwhile if you would just briefly, so that the audience does give a chance to speak, but so that we don't have to repeat the same questions, briefly describe how the mechanism, how it works, how it retracts, and what portions are visible and what portions aren't.
Okay. And in the process, I will be answering your question about its weight when it hits the water. Essentially, its operation is analogous to the operation of an extension ladder on a fire truck. When it's retracted, you have essentially two pieces of aluminum. One is a holder and the other is a ramp. And they are retracted underneath the house, and they are pulled underneath the house by cables. And I set the cables up, that is, I designed the cables similar to those in elevators, meaning that there's a redundancy and there's gearing so that actually there are three cables. There's a manual cable and two power cables. And if all three cables should manage to simultaneously break, it's a cushioned release. It can't drop or do anything catastrophic. So that there is a set of cables to pull it in and a set of cables to pull it out. The set of cables to pull it out, which is also redundant, is designed in such a way that once the ramp is all the way out, those cables not only will not pull it out any further, but they become a lock to keep it from going further. So that once the ramp is all the way out, the inner end of it is held by six cables plus two solid aluminum stopping blocks, which means that there are seven devices to keep it from going too far and falling into the water. As the pull cables bring this ramp out from under the house, and as it reaches its balance point, it will then hover, and the outer end, as it goes a little further out, will actually tip down into the water because the outer end becomes heavier than the inner end. At that point, when it's just hitting the water, the outer end is so light that if you stopped it there in that position had a small child pull by means of a rope on the other end, he could overbalance it back up out of the water. So in other words, when it first hits the water, it is very nearly at the balance point and not heavy at all. Obviously, as it goes further and further out, it becomes heavier and heavier because more and more of it is out there and less of it is counterbalancing. When it arrives at the float, it is at its heaviest, which will be about 1,000 pounds. That 1,000 pounds can be held up on the surface by basically the equivalent of a couple of foam billets. In other words, a few cubic feet of light or empty space will hold it up. At that point, it locks in, and once again, there's no weight exerted on the surface of the water because it's all held by the float after that. Does that satisfy you?
Does that answer your question, ma'am?
Yes.
Thank you. Excuse me, there was a gentleman in the back. Do you still wish to speak?
Yes, sir.
Ladies and gentlemen of the board, my name is Joe Calise, and I live at 15 Surf Road, which is in the Cape Cottage neighborhood. I wanted to make a couple of points in opposition to your granting of an approval of this project. First of all, I think it's important for you to know that the people that are in the Cape Cottage neighborhood all have deeded beach rights to this area, so that any approval that you grant has an impact on their property rights that are available to that neighborhood. I also want to make the point that the beach is a family-oriented neighborhood, and that the beach has always been had that kind of character in terms of its use. When Mr. Patius spoke earlier about the fact that the dock itself will only be available for a short period of time, it's important to note that that is precisely the time that the beach is available to the people in the neighborhood. As far as I'm concerned, the dock creates a safety hazard. In terms of the boat traffic that's in that cove, most of the boats that are at moorings in the cove are 20 feet or less in length. 30-foot boats are not characteristic of the kind of craft that are used in that area. I believe that the dock or float or ramp or whatever we're going to call it also creates an attractive nuisance to teenagers and other young people that might be inclined to be on the beach. Over the years, we have always had some level of extra policing during the spring and fall, primarily because teenagers and other children that are out of school are attracted to the beach, and I think that having this kind of a dock that's readily accessible and close by to the shore will increase that attractive nuisance. So for those two primary reasons, I think that granting this approval is adverse to the interests of the neighborhood at large, and to the extent that we have property rights that are deeded, I think it has an adverse impact on the property values in the neighborhood. So I'd like you to consider those things. And I'd like to ask one question in terms of the approval process. If I have a mooring in the cove, and I had to get the harbor master's approval to install the mooring, I don't know how this float will be anchored into the cove itself, but it seems to me that it is, in fact, a mooring, and I don't know if the harbor master has been brought into the process in terms of approving the specific anchoring of that float within the cove. Thank you.
I heard one question. Is the applicant able to answer that question? I know that you're going through Army Corps and Natural Resource Protection Act permits. Have you spoken with the harbor master with respect to the mooring location for the raft?
No, only with respect to the as I understand it, only with respect to the moorings that are out beyond my house.
For the boats?
Yeah, for the boats.
Thank you. Yes, over here, ma'am.
My name is Kate Borson, and I live at 10 Cottage Lane, which is at the corner of Cottage Lane and Canyon Lane, which is the access, one of the accesses to the beach. And at the moment, I have a question to follow up about the ramp, the gangway, when it comes down. What safety precautions exist to provide so that a child or an adult is not squished between the gangway and the raft as it is being deployed?
Well, the safety precaution is that everybody is owes a duty of due care to everyone else. It's the same safety precaution that I owe to you or anyone else. If I deploy that while somebody's down there, that's like smacking into somebody and killing somebody in an automobile or hurting somebody in an automobile. Everyone in our society has to conduct themselves with some level of care. With whatever we do, whether it's a float or an automobile or anything else. It's the same that Mr. Jellin expressed to me concern about children jumping off the cliff. Concern to everyone here. It's a concern to me. I have two teenage children. And my only advice to Mr. Jellin was that even in World War II, when I was growing up, they were jumping off that cliff, and they'll probably be jumping off that cliff in the next century. And it's, you know, we got to be careful. Mr. Jellin has to be particularly careful. He has to be particularly careful wherever he goes with his boat.
Thank you.
Well, there's one other. Why don't you come up and explain the electronic?
Mr. Patius? Mr. Waterman, for the record, would you state, are you a licensed or registered professional engineer, and do you carry liability insurance?
No and yes. I have designed ramps and floats and piers of all sizes and kinds for 15 years. I am not an engineer. I do carry enormous quantities of life of liability insurance. Okay. I just wanted to mention the fact that there are two safety devices built into this ramp extending device. The first is the fact that Mr. Jellin is not pushing. If he pushes the switch to make this thing go, he's not starting a precipitous process over which he has no control as it goes out. He's starting something that he can stop any time he wants to. He simply has to flip the switch back, and it will stop. And if he flips it another position back, it will retreat. So if we assume that Mr. Jellin is not going to look the other way while he's flowing the switch, then we have a safety in his judgment and his vision of what's out there when the ramp goes down. The other thing is that it has a sensing device of kinds that it will stop if it arrives at something which impedes its progress. It will stop itself. On the other hand, I would not want to rely on that for the safety of anyone. I think that what Mr. Patius said is certainly the primary means of protection here, and I just wanted it known that there is that it is designed in such a way that Mr. Jellin continues to have control in it all the way out.
Thank you. Yes, over here, ma'am.
My name is Connie Jordan. I live at 962 Shore Road. And while I can't top Mr. Patius is 50 years at Maiden's Cove. I can match it pretty close to 12 years short of that. And the raft that he mentioned as being on that side of the beach was a raft that Lloyd Knight put out as a service to the Cape Cottage Beach Association and as a service to the folks with deeded rights to that beach for the kids to use. He did it for many years. That did not go with the 78 storm. The pier did. The pier that went with the 78 storm belonged to the old Cape Casino. That was a totally different era. And I don't know about how he felt when that was swept away, but I think most other people that lived in that area felt at that point that it was aesthetically displeasing and had become an eyesore, and were glad to see it go. So although that is a precedent of sorts, it was for a totally different purpose. It was not for a private homeowner's use. It was for a public use. And I am going to reiterate what another gentleman said, I believe it was Mr. Calise, that the fact that this is going to be operationable for 3 months out of the year is a moot point. Those are the 3 months of the year that everybody else uses the beach as well. I'm sure that's very clear. People motor into that beach to the moorings. They very rarely motor to the beach. And as I understand this proposal, this raft is going to be at the beach. And it's a lot closer than people have traditionally been bringing their boats in, which in my way of thinking makes it a heck of a lot more dangerous to people swimming. The area that this is proposed to be placed is the sandiest area of the beach. It's the best swimming area of the beach. That's why Lloyd Knight used to put the raft over on that side of the beach, and that's where people are usually in the water. And I think that boats, no matter what time, going in and out of there is going to make it a lot more dangerous than perhaps has been presented. And one last thing I'd like to address was the stipulation of protection of significant vistas. As I said, I've been going to that beach for 38 years and don't intend to stop anytime soon, and that beach as it is a significant vista for me. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else from the public? Yes, the gentleman in the very back, please.
Good evening. My name is Dan Rabata. I live at One Cottage Lane in an adjacent area in Cape Cottage. And I'd like to address my objections to also the visual and aesthetic impact that this proposal would have, and also the comment about the protection of significant vistas. A sketch that was circulated by the association indicated that a portion of the structure, and I think I'd like to make that comment, that this has been variously referred to as an apparatus and an invention, and is not a conventional sort of structure contemplated under the previous ordinances. That even when retracted, it appears from the sketch that a portion of that, a couple of metal tracks, would protrude out over the water to some significant degree. I think that would have a significant visual impact, an adverse impact on the vista that we would all enjoy. The other part, and I must indicate that I do feel that both the designer and the owner are not proceeding with reckless disregard for beauty, but one of the things that strikes me as that part of that may be contingent upon the present owner. Real estate has a way of changing hands. While he may be verbally agreeing to a retracting of the structure 99% of the time, I'm not sure that that would bind any subsequent owner to retracting it for that portion of time during the summer or even during the year. So with those considerations in mind and emphasizing the visual impact and wanting to preserve Maiden Cove as it is and as it should be for all of us, I would have to reluctantly object to the proposal.
Thank you. Further, there's a lady in the back, is there? Can't sometimes see where the hands are coming from.
Good evening. My name is Natalie Burns, and I'm the chair of the Conservation Commission. The Conservation Commission has reviewed the application and the proposal and does not have any comments either in favor of the proposal or against the proposal. However, we did wish to note for the Planning Board our concern about the compliance of the project with Section 19-2D6 of the Site Plan Ordinance, which requires the design of the plan to minimize any adverse impact upon significant vistas. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, gentleman in the front, please.
My name is Michael Roy. I live at 51 Hillcrest Road. I'm not an attorney or a marine engineer. I am the father of three young children, and for the past 8 summers or so, my family and I have enjoyed the use of Casino Beach. And I would say that the things we've enjoyed about the beach have been the peace and quiet, the beauty, and the relative safety of the beach. It's a great place to bring little kids. You don't have to worry about their safety all that much. For one thing, boats don't come motoring in all that close to the shore. They generally just go to the moorings. It's very seldom that you see a boat come any closer than that. I guess I'd like to divide my comments into two areas of concern. One is the issue of aesthetics, the other is the issue of safety. Aesthetically, as you all know, beauty is a fairly subjective thing. I think my kids are unique, creative, and beautiful, but not everybody agrees with them, and I think that the engineer and Mr. Jelen have a certain amount invested in this project, and their judgments as to the beauty of this structure are somewhat biased in that regard. I would also submit that anybody's assessment of the impact of this project on the aesthetics, the scenic vista of the beach, really can't base that assessment on a single site walk or maybe even one or two site walks. Those of us who are regular attendants at the beach, regular users of the beach, I think are a much better judge of that visual impact. We know the comings and goings of the tide. We know how the light plays on the water, how the place looks from day to day. And I think we are much better judges of that aesthetic impact than those who are new to the neighborhood or who may just come down there on occasion. So the aesthetics are very subjective, and the other point I would just reiterate that was made earlier is that while Mr. Jelen and his engineer have gone to great lengths to try to mitigate the aesthetic impact, that mitigation is predicated on Mr. Jelen's willingness to retract the dock, as was previously stated, and also on the willingness of subsequent owners to retract the gangway. It also does not take into account the impact of boats that close to the shore and that impact on the scenic vista. The safety concerns, I think, have been expressed, but I just want to say one other thing, and that is that, once again, the impact of this project and of bringing boat traffic that close into the beach cannot be judged by a site walk that takes place in the spring of the year. Realistically, you really need to view the beach in action. You need to be there on a hot summer afternoon when it's crowded with kids, many of whom, by the way, are not escorted by parents. And I think Mr. Pechos overestimates the ability of the Beach Association to monitor and control a lot of these kids. They are there unescorted. I know as a parent, I've been there watching my three kids, and that's all I can do. And it's very difficult to account for everybody at all times. So you really have to see the beach in full tilt to really assess the impact of this project on safety. Furthermore, I don't think you can have it both ways. I don't think that you can have a project that offers no impediment to marine navigation, but yet allows for boats to come in close to the shore. The one allows the other, but then it does affect the safety issues. You are bringing boats much closer into shore than currently occur. So, for those reasons and the reasons cited before, I would like to object to this project. I would also like to say that although we've been educated tonight as to how permittable this is under the ordinances, I believe that the intent of those who drew up those ordinances was that those ordinances be applied with common sense, and that common sense should dictate that boats and propellers and kids don't mix. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Yes, over here, please.
James Hughes, 15 Garden Lane. I want to speak in favor of allowing this raft or dock. I remember growing up, the old raft that was put out there, and how much enjoyment that myself, my brother, friends had swimming to that dock, jumping off the dock, etc. A father of two kids, and if it's my understanding that the beach users would be able to use the raft, use the dock. As far as the aesthetics, nobody knows how it's going to look. It's not in the water right now. But when the raft was there prior, I guess the storm of 78, whenever it was, there was no problem with the aesthetics. As far as the safety issue, I do believe that this could actually enhance the safety. Having a place to swim to, I believe, helps a would help the safety factor, as opposed to swimming to a boat or a buoy further out. I believe that if a child or if an adult, etc., had a dock or raft to swim to, that would enhance the safety factor. So basically, for those three reasons, the recreational value, the aesthetic issue, and in terms of safety, I would urge you to allow this raft. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, sir, right here.
I'm Jim Harnan. I live at 13 Rocky Hill Road. My family and I have been active users of the beach for the last 7 to 8 years. I guess first off, I'd like to say that I do think Mr. Jelen and Mr. Waterman have been tried to be very, very sensitive to the users of the cove. They've gone to great lengths, I think, to explain their issues and explain what they've tried to do with the cove, and we appreciate that. However, there are two issues that I bring forward, which are safety and future owners, which I agree with a lot of things that have been stated before in regards to the use of the float as a twin use, as a boat float, I guess, for docking of boats and a swimming float. The previous float that was there was never used for a dual purpose. It was a single use purpose of a swimming float only. And my understanding from talking to older people in the area and have been there for a long time, there are also buoys that went around that float which protected people from boats from coming up to that float. And also from future users, I think, as I said, Mr. Jelen has been very sensitive to the concerns of the people that use the beach, but how concerned are future owners of that real estate going to be? It could potentially change hands, and if there is no, if those people are not that sensitive, there could be issues with that as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other members of the public? Anyone who hasn't spoken yet? Yes, in the blue dress. Excuse me, sir, the lady in the blue dress. With these lights, anything's blue.
My name is Eleanor Baker, and I'm a resident of 21 Birch Knolls. And I just want to go on record to say that I'm in favor, or I have no objection, or whatever. I spent my youth in Cape Elizabeth in that neighborhood. And prior to my parents living in that neighborhood, my grandparents lived in that neighborhood. And we didn't have any problem with the pier or the float. Parents watched out for their children, and that's the way it should be. And if Mr. Jelen would like to put a boat ramp there and has done such a good job and making sure it's retractable and not an eyesore. Let him do it.
Thank you. Anyone else who has a comment that hasn't been discussed? We've had the issue of aesthetics and safety. Anyone who hasn't spoken yet? Yes, sir.
Hi, I'm John Worsley. I live at 4 Kenyon Lane, and it's fairly close to the beach. And I'm going to make some of the same points as the other speakers, but with a little different perspective, because I sat listening to Mr. Patius and his very lengthy presentation, some of the technical aspects, although I noticed most of his technical aspects were not applicable. Most of Mr. Patius's presentation was based on his language and his value judgments. For example, he liked to use language which made things seem very favorable, saying that the float would be close to the shore. But I think he glossed over some issues. For example, he didn't tell us how many boats might be using this particular float. He didn't tell us whether or not there will be a boat permanently anchored at the float. He didn't tell us whether or not the mechanism would be there when Mr. Jellum is off sailing his boat. In other words, he tried to minimize what might be some of the issues and present it in his favorable light. And I understand why he did that. He's an attorney, obviously, with great experience, and I'm sure he might be being paid for his presentation. I was an officer of a yacht club in Rhode Island for quite a number of years. And every single float that we had was about the size of the float that Mr. Patius talks about. He tries to think or say that that's a small float. The fact is, it is not a small float. And many boats can be moored on a float that size. I also think that he has a particular, his own view of what is the integrity of that shoreline. I've not known Cape Elizabeth anywhere near as long as Mr. Patius. But in the time I have known it, there have not been any structures along that particular shoreline. It has a particular integrity, and I would be in favor of keeping that integrity. I am concerned about the safety issues. I'm concerned about environmental issues. And I'm particularly concerned about keeping the integrity of that particular shoreline. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else who hasn't had an opportunity to speak yet? Yes, sir.
My name is Robert Stockwell, and I live at 10 Cottage Lane, which is right near the beach, and our house does look out onto the beach and a portion of the beach where this dock would be. Several points I'd just like to go over, again, in a slightly different way. In my position would be that there's no real requirement or real need for this dock. I know the issue seems to be talking about having access to his moorings out there. Well, a lot of us have moorings out there, and we have plenty of, we find access to our moorings without having to have a special dock to get to them. If I understand the concerns that were brought up about a physical issue in terms of being able to drag a dinghy down over the beach, if that's the issue, I still don't see that that warrants having a private dock. There are other ways. If he's willing to spend this kind of money, he could easily have a launch on a crane that could come out from under his house and launch into the water to go out to his moorings. That would not require having a permanent structure such as this large float. I would also agree that for purposes of just having access to get to his boats, there doesn't seem to be a need for a float of this size. 24 feet long, is bigger than most of the boats that exist down there. Also, in terms of the attractive nuisance issue, that was specifically pointed out a little while ago, that at low tide, the near portion of that dock would be in 18 inches of water. Therefore, all the little kids on that beach who are out there now and don't have access to the deeper water would be able to get to this dock and go into the deeper portions of the water via the dock. That does not exist right now. I also agree with the issue of the visual impact and that the dock will not do anything to improve the vistas of this beach, especially according to the designs that were shown earlier, the gangplank effect left by the pier when it is retracted. Furthermore, from past experience, this particular dock is not really compatible with an open ocean environment such as where this is intended to be put. The dock that was there before was in the inner part of the cove, and yes, it was from a different era and for a different use, but it was on the inner part of the cove, which is the much more secure part of the cove, not this part of the cove, which is exposed to the open ocean waves. No one has brought up the issue here of what is the anchoring mechanisms for this float, what kind of chains, what impact those chains are going to have on the beach and other and to swimmers and other people using the beach, and how are they attaching to the dock. I think they may also present safety issues which should be addressed. Final issue I'd like to bring up is if the board decides to approve this dock, I think it should be approved with restrictions to minimize the impact for all of us. I would suggest in that area that it would limit the size of boats permitted to use the docks, the number of boats permitted to be at the dock at any one time, size of motors on those boats and the noise that they make. Some of us who do live right near there are impacted by the noise of boats coming in and out of that area. And I agree that yes, there are boats there, and yes, there's motor boats now there, but they primarily tend to be small boats with smaller motors. There's an issue in terms of like what times a day they would be able to come in and out. Would there be any restrictions in that sense? Can motor boats come in and out of there at 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning and disturb the peaceful use of the other residents of the area? That these restrictions should apply to all future owners. That the restrictions should apply to any future additions, such as lights, rails, benches, etc., to the structure. That the ramp should only be left in its extended position, specifically during times when it's required for accessing the dock. And therefore, there would need to be provisions for that ramp to be extended from the dock itself. So if you came in with your boat, I don't understand at the moment, unless you leave the dock out, extended, go to the marina, bring your boat over, that how you get up and down from this structure. That's never been explained. I know people keep talking about the fact that there used to be a dock there. The dock that used to be there was much, much smaller than the one that's proposed here. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else who would like an opportunity to speak that hasn't spoken this evening? Yes, ma'am.
I'm Judy Calise. I live at 15 Surf Road. And I just have one question. What kind of boats are we talking about coming in to use this? I've heard a sailboat and a motorboat, but exactly what size and what kind of motorboat and sailboat? A sailboat probably can't come up to this dock, but a motorboat might be able to. What are we talking about in terms of boats?
Why don't we go ahead and answer that question now? I'd like to know the number of boats on the dock and the size of the boats, please.
Sailboat is what, 20? 24-foot sailboat, day sailor, and a 30-foot, a 34-foot, mostly open cockpit. What is it? No, ma'am. Wishful thinking, but it's not. What's the make, Bill?
Tierra.
Tierra. It's a 34-foot tiara. And as to the, there were a couple other questions as to the number of boats.
Wait until the public hearing is closed, and then we'll go down on the whole list of questions.
Okay.
Okay.
There's two boats.
And they're not there permanently. They're only there to unload and offload, and then they're at the mooring.
Yes, because they would ground out.
Okay. Is there anyone who has not had an opportunity to speak yet? Gentleman in the front here, please.
Good evening. My name is Bill Tyler, and I live at 3 Kenyon Lane, which is right on Casino Beach. And I have many concerns that a lot of others have expressed, so I won't go through them again. I do want to say that we all appreciate the efforts and the expense and the time that that you've gone to try and make this an attractive setup. The only real concern I have, and it's been mentioned before, is the subsequent owner issue. And we all know that the efforts being made here, we all appreciate them, but we also know that real estate can change hands for a number of different reasons. And if there aren't airtight restrictions on this type of approval, if you decide to give them approval, then all this is for naught. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anybody else who hasn't had a chance to speak? The gentleman in the back, please.
Yes, my name is Alec Bruce, and I live with my family at 5 Cottage Lane. As you're well aware, many issues have been discussed tonight, and I won't subject the board to reviewing all of them because it would be redundant. However, I would like to simply expound on one of them that continues to concern me, and that's interference with the mooring area, which I believe is an issue that is specifically addressed in the ordinance. I have difficulty trying to determine just how far out the ramp extends into the cove. There's already quite limited mooring space available now. And as a matter of fact, just as a point of interest, it was stated that Mr. Jellin's boats are moored quite far out. And I would agree with that, but one of the reasons that they are, according to the people at Adams Marine, who also dropped my mooring, was because the size of his boats prevented them from putting them any closer than that. So that in itself gives some indication of what the limit, the mooring space is in there. And I'm just concerned that the ramp coming out, and this is one of several concerns, but again, those others have been addressed, just how much this will further impact an already limited mooring area. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anyone else who hasn't had a chance to speak that would like to do so this evening? I saw people who have already spoken raise their hands a second time. I would like to just keep it as a single. There's a gentleman here in the front.
I'm Al Glickman, and I live at 888 Shore Road. I'm for this proposal. I think that the applicant has done an excellent job in trying to take everybody's concerns. I do have several reservations, however. I think that when anybody buys property in the state of Maine on the coast, including I have a home on Great Diamond Island where I have a dock, and there was a dock at my house at 888 Shore Road previously. I don't know when it went out. I've only owned the property for about a dozen years. But the house was originally built there in 1875, but there was a dock, a large dock, maybe Harold remembers, out in front of my house. I've seen photographs of it and been told it existed.
1870, I don't know.
So that's when the house was originally built. At any rate, I think that it's a privilege, and I think that that goes with the ownership of the land. When you do build on the ocean, the great thing of coming to Maine is that you have such access to the water. And all over the Falmouth Foreside, you see many, many docks going out up and down that coast. And I think that Mr. Jellin should have a dock. However, I do have, like has been voiced tonight, some very strong reservations about what happens when Mr. Gellin doesn't own the property. And I would hope it'd be incumbent, I'd like to see you approve it, but I wouldn't like to see you approve it unless we had some deed restrictions that went with the land and that subsequent owners would have to comply with. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anyone else who hasn't had a chance to speak tonight that would like to do so?
Can I ask one question?
Certainly, go ahead.
Even Tina got this, two questions.
Kate Borson again, and as for having a hard time with change, I think the work that Mr. Gellin has done on his house has been wonderful, and I think most of us in the neighborhood are very pleased to have him there and doing that work. The house looks great. I have great safety concerns that have been expressed and concerns about the waterway that have been expressed, and so I won't go over those again, but I would like to ask, if you are going to approve this and if you are going to include restrictions, I would like to ask that he also be asked to be responsible when, not if, but when that float is destroyed in a storm. We had Hurricane Bob here 2 years ago. I don't think that float would survive. I'm sure he would be, but I'd like it to be in the restrictions so that others who follow him in ownership of that house are responsible, because we who live at the beach and members of the Beach Association regularly clean that beach and maintain it, and we don't want to have to take care of that as well. However, I do oppose the implementation of this. I don't think it's compatible with the neighborhood use of the beach. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anyone else from the public? Yes, ma'am.
My name is Jenny Kurtz, and I live on Windward Way. I recognize that a great deal of thought has been put into designing this float and ramp. I don't think that we will know